Okay, good afternoon and welcome to this meeting of the Conveners Group. I've received no apologies, though I know a number of committees are running currently, so I think two or three colleagues may be joining us through the course of the meeting. The meeting is taking place in public and your microphones will be therefore operated automatically. Agenda item number one is meeting with the First Minister, and I welcome the First Minister to the Conveners Group on his first anniversary in the role. So congratulations and thank you for sparing the time to be with us. The meeting will last around an hour and a half and we'll take a comfort break at around the hour mark. Some conveners have indicated that they wish to raise more than one issue, and I'll do my best to call all conveners at least once. In order to do so, obviously it would be helpful if questions and responses could be as brief as possible. As with previous meetings with the First Minister, it would be helpful if we could start with some general issues of interest to all the committees. And on that basis, we're going to start on the theme of framework bills. And I call first Finlay Carson on behalf of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee. Finlay.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, First Minister. I'd like to ask you for your reflections on the implications for parliamentary scrutiny and stakeholder consultation arising from framework legislation, especially in light of the Rural Affairs and Island Committee's report on Agriculture and Rural Communities Scotland Bill.
First of all, good afternoon to all of the conveners, and we genuinely appreciate the chance in this forum to get into depth of some issues that perhaps other forums don't allow for. And, in terms of framework bills more generally, let me say, from a Scottish Government perspective, we don't take a decision lightly around a framework bill. We know where some of the concerns lie in relation to parliamentary scrutiny around a framework bill. But in some cases it is necessary, and in the case of the Agriculture and Rural Communities Bill, which is a framework, bill in its nature, we do that to allow us to have the greatest level of flexibility that's absolutely required. So if I take the bill in question, it provides the flexibility to implement changes that are required to ensure that we remain aligned to future EU developments. We don't know what they necessarily will look like, but of course also particular schemes that are brought forward under future iterations of the EU Common Agricultural Policy. We also don't have as much certainty as we'd like in relation to agricultural funding post-2025 from the UK Government. I know that's an issue that is generally shared across the Parliament. So when it comes to framework bills, we understand the concerns that are there. We'll always work with the Parliament, including, of course, its committees, to determine whether or not there's further measures that we can bring in that would allow further scrutiny, for example, further down the line as legislation progresses or regulations are brought in at appropriate time post-consideration of any bill.
I think the main concern is about the scrutiny. I think there's general acceptance, particularly with the Rural Agriculture and Rural Communities Bill, that the framework bill is absolutely the right approach. But I'd like to express my disappointment that despite the fact that we're in the middle of a stage one, you yourself, First Minister, made a significant policy announcement at the NFU conference, despite a specific request from the committee that any such announcement should be made to the committee, and no correspondence relating to that announcement has actually been received as of yet. So it's around the scrutiny. My next question, I suppose, is specifically relating to timetables and timetable for stage one responses. I would suggest that we need more time between stage one reports being published and the debate to allow the Scottish Government more time to respond to specific conclusions and recommendations. And, you know, we have the committee received last night the Government's response to the Stage 1 report, which we'll be debating today, which gives us no time really to digest what's in it. But this report, sadly, spends more time noting everything and not actually engaging with the substantive points that the committee has set out. So can you maybe reflect on how, particularly with framework bills, more time should be given between stage one reports being published so that to allow the government to put together a more substantive response to committee's concerns?
My view on this is that some of the issues that Finlay Carson raises are very legitimate indeed. I will personally consider some of the stage one responses that are still due. I hope Finlay Carson will recognise, I'm sure he will, that the legislative timetable is packed. And we have a couple of bills, perhaps, that we would not even have anticipated. So the issue around Horizon cases, for example, is not something that was previously in our legislative programme. We'll now seek to bring forward Scottish-specific expedited legislation on that. So there's no doubt of the very busy legislative timetable we've got. That's important for government. We also recognise it's really important and has implications for our colleagues in Parliament and on committees as well. So I'll personally look to endeavour to take away from this session what Finlay Carson has requested. Can we look at what stage ones are due, our responses to those stage ones, and making sure there is an appropriate gap between stage one response and then, of course, the debate in Parliament. I think that's a very fair ask indeed. In terms of generally, again, I go back to the point I made around framework bills. I can give an absolute assurance to Finlay Carson. We don't consider framework bills as, for example, an easy option or something that we take lightly. That's why the majority of bills we bring forward are not framework bills. We do that where we require the necessary flexibility, and I think there is a good reason for that in this particular bill. But I take the point I made around that greater time gap between our stage one response and the debate itself. So I'll personally take a look at that. I'm happy to come back to the convener through the convener on this occasion.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to Kenneth Gibson on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration.
Thank you very much, convener. Good afternoon, First Minister. The Finance and Public Administration Committee has become increasingly concerned at the financial memoranda relating to framework bills that are coming before us. I mean, while we are supportive of co-designing new legislation, I have to say that our collective view is that this should be undertaken before stage one, wherever possible. And an example of that is obviously the National Care Service Bill, where if we'd accepted the original financial memorandum, you know, it would be somewhat different from what has finally emerged. I mean, the alternative of actually doing so after primary legislation is passed does undermine scrutiny and accountability, but it also increases the likelihood of financial risk, overspend and inefficiency. So given this state of affairs, why framework bills become almost the norm, and will the Scottish Government look again at such bills with a view to inclusion of all necessary provisions in primary legislation?
So again, I think there's a fair critique of the financial memorandum around the National Care Service Bill. We recognise that when the committee gave us their report and expressed publicly their concerns and expressed them to the government as well around the National Care Service. I suppose it does go back to my response to Finlay Carson. National Care Service is another example of a bill where I think all of us within the Parliament agree that there should be a significant level of co-design of policy with stakeholders. And while, of course, we can do that ahead of the introduction of a bill, and that's appropriate to do, a lot of these issues, if I take the National Care Service as an example, excuse me, very significant, very detailed, are going to have to work through their development with stakeholders, and therefore important that we don't delay the appropriate legislation to create the National Care Service while that co-design is happening, while that policy continues to be developed. But I take the point around cost and risk, that if that cost is not detailed to the committee, then there could be a potential for overrun. So I do accept that. I don't agree that the framework bill has become the norm, though I take the point that the member makes, that we should certainly not seek to make it the norm, that we should ensure that it is only used as a last resort, and where it is appropriate for it to be the case. So I will again reflect, and we are, of course, already reflecting on the specific costs in relation to the National Care Service.
I think, actually, the government's just making difficulties for itself, quite frankly. I mean, the National Care Service Bill is one in point. It's clearly a case in point. I mean, what people want to know is what this bill is actually going to deliver at the earliest stage possible. and that has to be in primary legislation, not something that may have bells and whistles upon it. And I don't agree that we're in a situation whereby it allows the delivery of legislation at an earliest possible date, because that legislation is not now programmed to 28-29. So clearly the framework bill is not allowing effective scrutiny, and it's not actually enabling bills to come forward and be implemented for the people who need that legislation enacted at the earliest possible date.
I would suggest that even within a framework bill, and if you take the National Care Service as an example, we can be really clear about what the intent of the bill is, what the bill is trying and attempting to do. So the principles of the National Care Service are explicitly understood because they're there within the bill. I take the point fully and accept the point fully that both Kenneth Gibson and Finlay Carson are making, that a framework bill, by its very nature, there'll be challenges around scrutiny. So what I can endeavour to do, and I think we've managed to do this to a point with the National Care Service, but always happy to reflect what more we can do, is when it comes to further regulations, when it comes to further secondary legislation that may be required as part of any bill, that gets the maximum and gives the maximum opportunity for parliamentary scrutiny, because the point of the framework bill is to give us flexibility. We don't fear scrutiny, particularly on something as significant as the National Care Service. In fact, we very much welcome it.
I know Sue Webber's got a question on financial memoranda, so I'll invite Sue Webber on behalf of the Education, Children and Young People Committee to raise your question.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, First Minister. You've spoken at length there about the detail or the lack of detail in the National Care Service financial memorandum. And our committee, the financial memorandum for the Children Care and Justice Bill, significantly underestimated the cost of its proposed changes, and we made it clear in our Stage 1 report and in our approach to Stage 2 that better, more accurate costings were essential and required. And it's not the only committee to raise the concerns about the absence of this information potentially hindering legislative scrutiny. We had correspondence from the Finance and Resource Committee sharing concerns. What action are you taking, First Minister, to ensure that the Scottish Government always provides full and detailed and the best possible information on costs arising from proposed legislation in order to assist parliamentary scrutiny?
I suppose it goes back to the very point that Kenneth Gibson made just a moment ago, which is that we will always aim and endeavour to give the best possible estimate around what any proposed legislation may well cost and the implications of that legislation. We do that primarily because we, of course, want to ensure that is scrutinised by Parliament and by the committees of this Parliament, but we also do it because we need to know the cost of it for our future budget. So it doesn't serve any purpose in a financial memorandum and the estimates in a financial memorandum being off by any amount whatsoever. So again, from my perspective, my direction to all Cabinet Secretaries and Ministers is very clear, that when a financial memorandum goes to any committee, it should be given detailed consideration to the best possible estimate. And there will always be estimates to a point, given the nature of legislation, how things can develop, so on and so forth. But we always endeavour to give the best, and Sue Webber gives an example of where some of the costs have been off, and we have to accept that critique as a fair one. But it's nobody's interest, neither this Parliament's nor the Government's, for any financial memorandum to be wildly off. So I can give an absolute assurance to Sue Webber that my clear direction to both Ministers and Cabinet Secretaries is to provide the most accurate detail we possibly can. And if there is any reason why detail cannot be presented, it's to be really upfront with the committee on the reasons for that.
I suppose, thank you, First Minister. I mean, Kenny Gibson did speak there about the additional risk that this approach can have, but I mean, these are some of our most vulnerable people in this specific bill, and the costs were significantly underestimated, and what the changes and challenges might be to those that would be involved in implementing the legislation. And I think all the evidence we had was the uncertainty, the fear, how are we going to implement something when the resources don't follow? And as I said you know, so I think we need more assurance from yourself that this can't continue to happen when we're getting bills that are around some of our most vulnerable people.
Yeah, well, I don't agree that it constantly happens. I mean, there'll be occasions where the government may well underestimate a cost, and we've got to accept the committee's scrutiny. This, for me, is one of the strengths of the committee system. Sue Webber's absolutely right to say that the government should ensure that it's providing as accurate information as it possibly can in a financial memorandum. But to me, this does demonstrate the efficacy of the committee system that we have through that evidence taking that you'll do with a range of stakeholders through your own detailed scrutiny of the financial memorandum. It is fair, I think, for the committee to then challenge government back on the occasions where the estimates you believe to be or committees believe to be underestimating the cost involved. So I think that's a strength of the committee system, but I take the point that Sue Webber makes, and indeed other members have already made, that as detailed information, as accurate information should be presented. And I go back to my original point, doing so is not just in the interest of this Parliament, it's in the interest, of course, of the people we serve, but very much in the interest of the government when it comes to development of our own budgets.
I'm now going to call Stuart McMillan on behalf of the Delegated Powers and Law Report.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, First Minister. It follows on from some of the previous questions. I mean, obviously, every bill will have delegated powers, and that's a normal part of the legislative process. And I think certainly colleagues spoke about the framework bills. I mean, I think the definition of a framework bill is actually very much up for questioning in terms of what that is. But what considerations does the Scottish Government take into account when deciding to delegate a power or not in a bill, and to satisfy itself of the appropriateness of its choices?
In terms of delegated powers, I mean, it is recognised by this Parliament that delegated powers are an accepted part of the legislative landscape. There are obviously differences in the types of issues that they deal with, and the different types of procedure, negative, affirmative, which can be applied, but I think it's generally accepted that they are an accepted part of the legislative landscape. From a government's position, we will obviously look at the issue on a case-by-case basis. We'll generally try to strike the balance between appropriateness, where is it appropriate to have certain powers in the face of a bill, and we know the challenges around that. I don't need to tell anybody around this table around the challenges of putting particular powers in the face of a bill. It locks you in. It has a certain level of rigidity and flexibility on the face of the bill, and then therefore what's suitable under delegated powers, which can be perhaps developed and updated more quickly, but crucially subjected to parliamentary scrutiny. And this is where I think the members' committee, of course, plays a really important role, because it is for the government, and we take this responsibility very seriously, to fully justify and explain the use of delegated powers that it takes in bills, hence the delegated powers memorandums, which, of course, the committee will examine, explore and challenge where appropriate and where necessary. And, of course, where the Parliament or indeed the committee has any concerns specifically around a particular delegated power, then I can give an absolute assurance to Stuart McMillan that the government will listen and, where appropriate, respond hopefully to a point where the committee is satisfied with the reasons and rationale for our use of a delegated power.
Well, thank you.
Sticking with scrutiny, I'm going to call Martin Whitfield on behalf of the Standard Procedures and Public Appointments Committee.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, First Minister. Yes, sticking with the sort of overarching theme of the first few questions about scrutiny, my first question is in relation to the vehicles that we process bills through to legislation of Stage 1, Stage 2 and Stage 3. And it's become more obvious that at Stage 2, the government are seeking to avoid is too strong a word, seeking to move some of the decisions to Stage 3, which removes the scrutiny which you yourself have commented that one of the strengths of the committee system is evidence taking, and that we are starting to see new amendments that sometimes fundamentally shift parts of bills that are only being brought to the public eye at Stage 3, which means that the committees have been unable to do that fundamental role that they take in this unicameral Parliament of seeking evidence, inquiry, and the views of those who the bills will affect, those who have to implement bills, and we lose that evidence taking. Is this something that, as First Minister, you're aware of? And is it something that, as First Minister, I'd hope you'd share with me that I have great concern about that? So new events at stage three going unscrutinised, causing challenges. And I would seek your views on how this can be avoided going forward.
I'm more than happy to answer the question in the general. I hope, Convener, you won't mind, because I'm not attempting to do this in any provocative manner, but is there a specific example of the issue that Martin Whitfield raises that he wants me to particularly, or is it more in the general? Because if there's a specific issue, then I'm more than happy to address that.
I mean, there are individual cases that I could make reference to, but I don't think that's helpful. But there is... an apparent, maybe subjective view that there are more changes being proposed at stage three than in previous sessions. And sometimes, indeed, it would appear that it's those amendments that cause us challenges and problems, both within and out with Scotland. So it's really just seeking your view on whether, as you've said, you agree with the strength of the committee system, that actually the full case, with regard to government bills, should be presented at stage two so that evidence inquiry can take place to test those.
Well, I'm grateful. I genuinely was just curious if there was a very specific example. There was more a general concern that Martin Whitfield had. In terms of the committee and the strength of the committee system, I genuinely believe in the strength, and I've been involved in many bills over a number of different ministerial guises in the past, and those bills have... frankly, been improved, have been bettered by going through the committee system, by compromising with colleagues in committee and indeed those who are not in committee ahead of stage three. And I'll come back to that point in a minute. Of course, it is during stage one evidence consideration of the stage one report where the committee will obviously take the vast majority and vast bulk of its evidence as opposed to, for example, at stage two or indeed stage three. But I take the very point, having been involved in a number of stage twos before, that when an amendment is being debated, there's a full and frank discussion and quite a fair degree of depth. So where possible, I do think it's wise for the government, for our amendments, to bring as many forward at stage two where we can. Martin Whitfield will be well aware that often what happens at stage two is that there's a good debate and discussion around an amendment. There is an agreement for the government to work with a particular member and then to see if they can get to some compromise position ahead of time for stage three. And I think that's a good way, generally, of working. I don't think, and I'm again happy to be challenged on this. I wouldn't suggest that there isn't a full and frank debate at stage three. It tends to be that this Parliament, although we try to avoid this Parliament, will sit well into the evening when there's a number of amendments at stage three. It's hardly ideal, of course, in terms of the family-friendly Parliament that we try to aspire to be. But I would say that I've never seen a stage three unnecessarily curtailed in terms of its debate by the presiding officer and indeed the DPOs. I would say that stage three certainly allows for debate, frank and free exchange of views on any particular amendment. But I'm also not disagreeing with Martin Whitfield that if amendments, and certainly substantial amendments, that significantly have an impact on any piece of legislation, if they can be brought forward at stage two, then that is better for everybody involved.
Okay. Thank you. We've touched on timetabling already, but I know Audrey Nicholl, on behalf of the Criminal Justice Committee, has a couple of questions in this area. Audrey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and my apologies for my late arrival this morning. First Minister, the Hate Crime and Public Order Scotland Act, which comes into force on the 1st of April, creates offences relating to the stirring up of hatred based on certain characteristics. And we all understand the devastating impact of hate crime, and everyone must play their part to challenge it. So an issue that recently highlighted to the Criminal Justice Committee is that of the preparedness of police officers to effectively apply the law in the way that it's intended. So I wonder if the First Minister can outline how the Scottish Government has engaged with Police Scotland and other bodies to ensure officers are fully prepared to use the legislation and confident in their application of the law, but while recognising the importance of maintaining public confidence with particular regard to the important principle of freedom of speech.
Can I thank the member for the question? I think for me, I would take, before I go into the specifics, I would certainly take, and I hope other members can take, a fair degree of comfort from the fact that we've had stirring up offences in Scotland since 1986, most of my life, born in 1985. So for most of my life, there's been a stirring up offence in relation to racial hatred. And actually, the threshold for that stirring up offence is lower than the thresholds that are created by the Act. The Act creates stirring up offences with a higher threshold for the characteristics that it applies to. So stirring up offences are not new, but notwithstanding that point, of course, there's been a fair degree of work and a fair amount of preparation by Police Scotland and other stakeholders as well. In the summer of 2022, we established the Ministerial Oversight Group, and the purpose of the Ministerial Oversight Group was to assist with providing justice partners at the time, give them the time and the support that they needed to complete, first of all, a number of IT changes that were required. We know that there was a number of IT changes required in terms of data collection and collation, but also, importantly, and this is to the point that Audrey Nicol makes, for the delivery of a robust package of training and guidance for police officers. And of course, training for police officers is a matter for the Chief Constable, but we have been working closely with Police Scotland in that regard. And the training of police officers doesn't just focus on, of course, the importance of the new offences that are created within the Act. That is important, and that's, of course, of key consideration. But also the training that's provided does ensure that police officers are fully cognisant of their human rights of human rights obligations. And again, in particular, training does include matters in relation to protection of freedom of expression, which enables officers to, I think, best respond to any complaints around hate crime. And I would go, I would end on the point that I've made at several occasions in relation to this particular Act, is that this Act does, of course, have explicit freedom of expression protections built within the bill, as well as the more indirect protections that are built in, for example, the fact that any legislation in this Parliament must comply with the European Convention on Human Rights. And the final thing I would say, actually, is the Chief Constable herself gave assurances just earlier this month to the SPA board that officers are trained, have sufficient capacity to undertake the implications of the legislation, and that the systems are in place in Police Scotland to be able to deal with this legislation too.
Okay, thanks very much. I wonder if I can move on to my second question on the Post Office Horizon issue. So the First Minister will be aware that the Cabinet Secretary for Justice wrote recently to the Criminal Justice Committee to say that regrettably it had not been possible to pursue UK-wide legislation to overturn the prosecutions of sub-postmasters and postmistresses, and that separate Scottish legislation would be needed. So can the First Minister give Parliament a broad idea of when we can expect that legislation, and give an assurance that there will be time in the expected timetable for the bill for robust scrutiny, which will allow some of those affected by the scandal to have their voices heard?
I can thank Audrey Nicol for the question. I know the degree of interest that is not just in Parliament, but of course within the public when it comes to those cases that have been affected by the Horizon scandal. I would say that it remains our position, as has been articulated, of course, publicly and indeed directly with UK government, that UK-wide legislation would be better given it would apply fairly right across the nations of the UK in regards to post-submasters and post-submistresses that have been affected. But it's become clear from engagement with the UK government, and again their publicly articulated position, that they do not wish to apply UK-wide legislation. It will be England and Wales legislation only. That's a matter of regret, not just expressed by the Scottish Government, but also by the government in Northern Ireland also. But that being said, we are in the position we are in, and therefore Scottish-specific legislation will be required unless there's a change forthcoming from the UK government. We are working closely with the UK government to understand what will be in the bill, and I do have to say I have some initial concerns around the UK bill. I'd be happy to write to the convener with more details around those concerns, but if we were to almost exactly mirror the UK bill, although that we couldn't quite do that because of the differences in Scots law and law in England and Wales, but if we were to almost mirror the broad scope, we would be in danger of overturning convictions of people who I think, if these cases were made public, and again, I'll seek to see if we can do that, I think the public would be pretty horrified at that. So we have to make sure that we're striking the absolute right balance between ensuring there is timely and expedited access, in fact, to the UK compensation scheme, because we all recognise, everybody in this Parliament recognises, sub-postmasters, sub-postmistresses have waited too long. But at the same time, we want to make sure that people who have genuinely committed a crime, their conviction is sound, do not then have access to £600,000 of compensation. And trying to get that balance absolutely right is going to be hugely important. In terms of the timetabling point that Audrey Nicholl raises around the bill, because we do have to be cognisant of what's in the UK bill, in order for people to be able to access compensation here in Scotland, it's going to be crucial that, in fact, it will be an inevitable reality that although we can seek to introduce legislation here in Scotland ahead of the UK bill completing its process, we'll have to wait to see the final detail of the UK bill, because amendments that may be made, in order for us to finalise our own legislation. The trouble with the timetabling of all of this is that the UK bill might well not conclude until the end of July. Of course, this Parliament would be in recess at that point, and therefore we may have to consider, it would be up for the Parliament to consider a recall. I mean, the government would be happy to of course, be involved in any recall, but it may be that we have to consider that bill in the course of the parliamentary recess.
OK, I'm conscious of the amount of questions we need to get through, so the questions are going to have to be a bit briefer. And, First Minister, I'd encourage slightly briefer answers as well. A brief supplementary on this, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you. Just on the point of the working closely together with the UK government, now 24 LCMs have been passed in this parliamentary session between also from both governments. So that highlights that joint working has been there. Was that a consideration or not a consideration of the UK government when it came to this particular bill? Because, as you said, certainly today, but also in the chamber, the preference would have been to actually have utilised the LCM process to expedite this new legislation.
Yeah, I mean, obviously I can't answer on behalf of the UK government what would have been their consideration or not. I think part of the consideration undoubtedly would have been the difference in legal systems between England and Wales and Scotland and, of course, in Northern Ireland. But we did say to the UK government that we could, of course, modify UK legislation to take account of Scottish-specific offences that might be different to English-specific offences, for example. But it really would be for the UK government to give an answer to why they chose not to have a UK-wide approach, which is not what we wanted, or neither what the Northern Irish wanted.
Sticking on initially, certainly on timetable, I'm going to call Edward Mountain on behalf of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. Edward.
Thanks very much and good afternoon, First Minister. Given the Climate Change Committees has reported that the Scottish Government's interim 2030 emission targets is now beyond what is credible, when will you be bringing forward your climate change plan? Surely that's really urgent. And when will you be making changes to the legal targets?
So we'll bring forward a response to the Climate Change Committee's pretty sobering report within weeks. I'd hope to do it shortly after the Easter recess, because, of course, Given the nature of that report from the Climate Change Committee, we have to demonstrate accelerated action. In terms of what we will and won't do, well, if I take the 2030 target, as has been referenced by Edward Mountain, it's fair to say when this Parliament first considered that target, the Climate Change Committee expressed its concern about it being perhaps overambitious and being potentially unachievable. It's now confirmed that that is the case. Yet, of course, everybody in the Parliament, every single political party, came together to put that target into legislation and for Scotland to have that ambitious target. But it is not, as the Climate Change Committee has said, achievable. And therefore, we will bring forward our response. I won't go into detail on what that response will be. Obviously, that is still being formulated, but it will look at an accelerated package of action, because that's what the Climate Change Committee have demanded. And of course, Edward Mountain is right. We will have to consider what is in the legislation, given the fact that the Climate Change Committee have said that 2030 target is no longer credible.
OK, on a slightly different subject, but on timetabling. First Minister, on the 23rd of November, you signed off the appointment of Mike Russell to be the new chair of the Scottish Land Commission. On the 29th of November, the information was shared in absolute confidence with the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee, and we programmed to take evidence on that on the 12th of December. On the 1st of December, the information was leaked by SNP press release before the committee had even considered it. Do you think that's respectful of the committee's procedure?
Well, again, I will absolutely examine and explore this issue. We mean no disrespect whatsoever to the Parliament, indeed. And look, I think Mike Russell will do an excellent job as chair, but we never seek to undermine the processes or indeed the integrity of this Parliament. So it was important, I think, when Mike Russell was confirmed as taking on this role, really important that he stepped back from his position as party president and, of course, to avoid any perceived conflict of interest. It was the right thing to do, but, of course, I'll reflect on this very specific instance. I can give an absolute assurance to Edward Mountain, anything we do as a political party, and I'm taking off my First Minister's hat, leader of the SNP hat here on, we don't seek to undermine the Parliament's processes in any way, shape or form.
OK, and the final convener question on timetabling. In September of this year, the Clyde and Hebrides ferries contract ends. The Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee agreed with the principle of a direct award subject to the islanders approving. The islanders haven't approved. When are you putting it out to tender, and will it be before September, or will the contract just run on indefinitely?
Our aim is to continue to make sure we meet that September deadline. I do think the direct award, and Edward Mountain has said that that was agreed by... subject to Island, I was going to get to that caveat. Agreed by the committee, subject to Islanders' approval. So we are working with our stakeholders. We know how important. I've travelled on many islands, and not just as my time as Transport Minister, but in other portfolios as well, to our islands that are affected in the Clyde and Hebrides route. And therefore, we want to seek to ensure that they have confidence in that direct award. So we are seeking to meet that September deadline, which was a question that Edward Mountain asked.
I'm going to come back to Kenny Gibson for a couple of questions in relation to finance and public administration. Kenny.
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. First Minister, on the 14th of March, the Scottish Fiscal Commission published a very sobering report exploring the impact on the public finances of meeting Scotland's statutory net zero emission targets by 2045. And they said, and I quote, how unmitigated climate change could have catastrophic impacts on individuals, businesses and the public finances, close quote, if we fail to meet these targets. However, the cost of meeting these is estimated to be 18% of our entire capital budget year on year when we have a declining capital allocation. The UK and Scotland cannot each meet their climate targets without cooperation. Therefore, do you agree that the fiscal framework must be revisited specifically to address the damage caused by climate change and the need to adapt to it and mitigate it?
Thank you, Kenny Gibson, for the question. I don't disagree with the premise of the question. We look at how significant the costs are going to be in order to achieve net zero, then I don't think there's many governments in the world that are going to be able to do that solely through public finance. If I just look at what the cost of decarbonising heat in buildings is going to cost, there is again, as I say, not many governments, if any, are going to be able to fund that from the public purse alone. And therefore, leveraging private finance is going to be absolutely crucial to meeting our net zero targets and ambitions. And that's why I'm engaging personally very extensively with investors right across the world in order to try to leverage in some of that private finance where possible. And that's also what the Scottish National Investment Bank is looking and seeking to do to some of de-risk some of that private capital and investment as well. I agree with, again, the general premise of Kenneth Gibson's question that there's absolutely a need for, I think, UK government to understand the implications of net zero, the cost of net zero when it comes to funding of the Scottish Government, and in fairness for the Scottish Government through its engagement with local government to understand the impact on local government in relation to meeting the net zero targets. What doesn't help in any of this is in the next 5 years that £1.3 billion cut to our capital budget is going to impact and affect our ability to move at pace when it comes to investment in our net zero infrastructure.
Yes, I mean, the Scottish Fiscal Commission said, frankly, that the UK can't meet its own targets without Scotland, and Scotland can't meet its targets without the UK. That's why I mentioned the fiscal framework being reviewed. But the SFC also said this morning that Scotland's capital budgets will be cut by 20% in real terms over the next 5 years. Now, the Scottish Government is currently reprofiling and reprioritising its capital spend, but the Finance and Public Administration Committee won't actually see this until near the end of May. I mean, First Minister, surely this should be an ongoing process such that priorities are always clear within any given spending envelope, regardless of what the capital allocation is. So you'll always have a priority list within each heading, and whether it's increased or reduced, you'll know what the priorities are. It seems odd to me that this whole thing is having to be reworked over a period of some months.
No, look, I wouldn't necessarily agree with that in the sense that, of course, when it comes to our infrastructure right across the board, whether it's health infrastructure, transport, justice infrastructure, or indeed net zero infrastructure, of course, there will be some projects that are further along the route in terms of outlaying business case, final business case, along the process in terms of getting and receiving Scottish Government investment, and we can be absolutely upfront about that. There will also be projects that are huge in scale. So if you take the replacement Monklands is probably the most obvious example, and obviously we're committed to that replacement of Monklands. That cost is vast in comparison to a capital project that may well cost a few million or even tens of millions. And therefore, getting absolute certainty, particularly from the UK government around a capital infrastructure, a capital budget, then determines what projects we can take forward, at what scale, and what has to be reprofiled out to the right, what might have to take longer than we initially envisaged. So the Deputy First Minister has, of course, agreed to come to Parliament, as the member said, at the end of May, in terms of our infrastructure investment plan, and we're currently working through the detail of that. It is an extremely difficult capital budget that we've been given, and as I say, from a Scottish Government perspective, we'll seek to do what we can within the budget we've got, but where it's also appropriate, we'll seek to see where we can leverage in appropriately private finance when I think about certain projects in the future.
Thanks. I'm going to ask Sue Webber, who's a related question. Sue.
No, thank you, First Minister. When we were conducting our pre-budget scrutiny in the Education, Children and Young People's Committee, we did struggle to get responses to specific questions on specific budget lines. For example, despite our committee asking the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills in person and in correspondence, and indeed the Public Audit Committee asking the Director General of Education and Justice, we're still not clear how the £56 million in savings across demand-led programmes at the Scottish Founding Council, what that means, and that the Deputy Minister set that out in November 2023. We still need to know how that's been broken down between college and university sectors, and we're still trying to get to the bottom of this, which is clearly important in terms of our further and higher education. So given the importance of the scrutiny process overall and of the decisions being made and the impact that they will have, do you think committees should be provided with clear, transparent and detailed information from the Scottish Government?
They absolutely should, and we endeavour to do that. And it's precisely because of that point that sometimes it takes a bit of time to work through, for example, with the Scottish Funding Council. So I can say to the member very clearly that those discussions with the Scottish Funding Council are very much ongoing and have been for a number of weeks and indeed months, because we want to ensure that where we have to unfortunately bring forward efficiencies because of the nature of our allocation from the UK government, then we've got to do that in a way that minimises the impact on learners, for example. So those discussions are ongoing, and we'd be hopeful of getting you the detail within a matter of weeks.
Look forward to that.
Thank you. We are now going to move on to the theme of health, and I call first Claire Hoggie on behalf of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee. Claire.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, First Minister. And before I start, I'll refer members to my register of interest and that I hold a bank nurse contract with Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS. During the recent Stage 1 process, the National Care Service, the committee received both oral and written evidence of workforce challenges in the social care sector in particular. Recruitment and retention caused great concern of what is a highly skilled workforce, and it's a particular challenge there. Given how crucial the social care workforce are in delivering a national care service and indeed delivering care every day to our communities, could the First Minister advise what steps the Scottish Government are taking to address these issues?
There's no doubt in my mind that Claire Hawkey is absolutely right that when I speak to social care providers, whether it's in-house local authority provision or indeed private provision, the number one issue is workforce. And it comes down to not just recruitment but retention of workforce. It's why the Scottish Government in our budget, of course, confirmed an increase social care pay to £12 an hour. Now, I know there's some within the social care sector, understandably, who want the government to go further. But, of course, we operate within the limitations of our budget, and that's a significant increase. Not only that, our manifesto, of course, as the member will be more than aware, pledged to commit 25% of our health budget to increase our social care spending by 25% over the Parliament. We've managed to do that already, 2 years ahead of target. What I would say to Claire Hawkey is we're also working with the sector on that retention piece. So what more can we do around fair work, around terms and conditions, not waiting for the National Care Service to come in to fruition, but what can we do in advance of that through the Fair Work Social Care group that we have, the Fair Work and Social Care group that's been established now for a while. The other final point I suppose I'd make around recruitment in particular, it's why we've raised concerns, and indeed the sector has raised concerns around migration policy and recent changes by the UK government around migration. I think most people looking at that, those changes objectively, believe them to be an act of incredible self-harm to the social care sector in particular. Undoubtedly, there's a need for a rethink by the UK government on that particular policy.
Thank you. And you've almost preempted my entire second question there, First Minister, which was about the social care workforce, because we know that many of them come from outside of Scotland. Many EU nationals, as well as workers from other countries, come here, and we're aware of the impact that Brexit has had on that sector, as well as the immigration policies that you referred to. I know it's a wholly reserved matter, but has Scottish Government given some thought about how they could respond to that and how they're challenging to, or how they are attempting to tackle some of those challenges of attracting some of that workforce to Scotland?
Well, we have asked for the UK Government to give us, to consider the impact of the changes, and can there be further changes that are made in relation to migration policy. It is a deeply unfair policy. It was announced at the time there was an almost unified response from the social care sector, not just in Scotland but right across the UK, about the impact this would have. And I don't need to tell any member here that social care is absolutely vital in its own right, but also vital to the recovery of our NHS more generally. We have a number of people, far too many, over 1,800 who are in our hospitals who have no clinical reason to be in hospital, and that we want to get them either to their homes or as close to home as possible, and that then affects and impacts the flow through our hospitals. So the recovery of health services, I would say, really dependent on social care, and that's why it's such a valued profession. It's why we have again given further money to increase pay. But I would hope that there's a rethink from the UK government, as this is not genuinely not a party political issue. The sector has been unified right across the UK in saying how damaging those migration reforms will be.
Thank you. I'm going to now invite Karen Adam on behalf of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee to stick with the health theme. Karen.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, First Minister. First Minister, at the end of October 2023, the Scottish Government announced that it would be publishing Scotland's HIV transmission elimination delivery plan in the coming months. We have held two formal sessions on this, one of which was yesterday with the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health, where she confirmed that the delivery plan had been published that morning. Can I ask you, First Minister, what are your hopes for this plan? How will it be promoted and how success will be measured, but also recognising the ongoing work to reduce stigma?
Well, again, can I recognise Karen Adam's own interest in this? And as you say, we are absolutely committed to HIV transmission elimination. And we have seen massive amounts of advancement in technology and medical treatment over the years. So we've had huge advances in the prevention and indeed the treatment of HIV, and that we have a real opportunity to eliminate new cases of the virus in Scotland by 2030. So the HIV transmission elimination proposal that was published in December 22 emphasised the need to ensure that people living with HIV receive that timely and appropriate diagnosis, that appropriate treatment, and crucially that appropriate care as well. The delivery plan, of course, will then outline, and it has outlined, the actions that we'll take to achieve that goal. And the point about stigma, I think, is hugely important. The government is actively seeking to do what we can to reduce stigma, not just for the important reasons of broader societal understanding, but also, of course, to ensure that people come forward as early as possible should they require diagnosis or indeed treatment or care. I don't doubt that there's more that can be done in that space.
Thank you. My second question, First Minister, touching on what you've said there about the advances in medicine, it does mean that a person living with HIV, which it can be undetectable, viral load, and they cannot pass the virus on to others. Does the Scottish Government have any plans to update the rules relating to culpable and reckless conduct in situations of intentional or reckless transmission of or exposure to sexually transmitted infections to reflect these advances?
Can I thank the member for the question? We don't have any particular plans at the moment to review that particular offence, the reckless conduct or intentional or reckless transmission of the exposure to sexually transmitted infections. But, of course, given that Karen Adams has asked the question, I'm more than happy to give that issue an exploration or indeed further examination. It is, of course, ultimately a matter for the Crown to determine whether or not there is sufficiency of evidence to prosecute a particular case, and COFS, the Crown and Procurator Fiscal Service, have published prosecution policy on sexual transmission of infection, which sets out the reasons why they would or would not seek to prosecute an alleged offence. But on the issue of the advancement of technology, the advancement of treatment, I should say, and the question that Karen Adams asked, I'm happy to give that consideration, come back to the member, I'll come back through the convener directly.
Thank you.
I think before we go to the comfort break, I'm going to invite Richard Leonard at least to initiate in the area of health and any subsequent questions on behalf of the Public Audit Committee. Richard.
Thank you very much indeed. Good afternoon, First Minister. The Auditor General told the Public Audit Committee just last week, and I'll quote him, there are a range of strategies, plans and policies in place for the future delivery of healthcare, but no overall vision. How do you respond to that?
So before I respond to that, just on the point of the comfort break, it's entirely a matter for you, convener, but I know part of the reason for the comfort break was to allow me to go rinse my mouth out during Ramadan, given that we have a session ahead of us. I'm more than happy to continue if it's up to the committee, but if you want to have a comfort break for other members, then of course that's well understood. In terms of Richard Leonard's question, I disagreed with the point that the Auditor General made in relation to an overall vision. I take on board the points that are absolutely made around strategy and the need for implementation of strategies, but we do have a vision in terms of the health care, health and social care, and that ultimately is to ensure that we treat as many people at home or as close to home as possible, and when it comes to our acute sites, our secondary care, to ensure that we have sustainable health services going forward. That means of course having the appropriate levels of staffing, but of course also ensuring that we use technology and technological advances as much as possible in order to help with the demand on the service, but trying to ultimately we take a preventative approach, and that's been a vision of this government for, well, I would say almost since its inception in 2007. So I would disagree with the Auditor General, respectfully disagree on that point, while taking on board the other concerns that were raised by Audit Scotland.
Well, do you accept the Auditor General's findings that the government's national strategy for economic transformation lacks not only the economic leadership group we were promised 2 years ago, but lacks leadership full stop?
Well, again, the points of the leadership group, I think, are not unreasonable in terms of the points that have been made. In terms of the national strategy and economic transformation, I'm really proud of the strategy. I'm really proud of the experts and those that have helped to drive forward that work. I'm very also proud of what we've managed to achieve in terms of the economy here in Scotland, not without its challenges, not without really strong headwinds, Brexit being, of course, one of the most obvious. Despite that, just last month, we saw figures that showed private sector employment growth in Scotland better than any other nation or region in the UK. So challenges, undoubtedly, but I'm proud of what we've managed to achieve in the face of very strong headwinds in terms of Scotland's economy.
Final question from me. I mean, the committee has also taken evidence on the college sector and planning for skills, and you've announced that Skills Development Scotland will be replaced, that the Scottish Government will take over control of training and skills. I was out during apprenticeship week, as I'm sure you were, when I met with college lecturers, SDS staff, private training providers, employers, trade unions, none of them know what's going on. They also think there's a lack of leadership there as well.
Well, again, that we engage, as you've already, as Richard Leonard has already acknowledged, we engage with our college lecturers, with our trade unions, with our learners in relation to the changes we seek to make. I hope that Parliament would recognise there's been now a number of reviews into the skills sector, and I commend those reviews and the Withers review in particular. It is appropriate now that the government then works with partners, including the ones that Richard Leonard has recognised, in order to now take forward and implement those changes. That in its nature can take some time between a report being published and then deciding on the way forward. I would absolutely hope, and it would be my expectation, and it's my belief, that ministers and cabinet secretaries take forward those changes, co-designing with those that are involved in providing education and helping with skills, such as colleges, college lecturers, staff and indeed learners as well. If there are specific instances of people who don't feel engaged that Richard Leonard has come across, then I'm more than happy to hear from him, because my expectation always, and it is my belief, that we engage and co-design before making any substantial changes, the nature of which we're looking at in the skills sector.
Okay, having promised a comfort break, I'm reluctant to perform a humiliating U-turn, so we will have a very short comfort break. We will get back underway at 1:03 precisely. Thank you. OK, let's get back underway. And I'm going to start on the theme of housing and invite Ariane Burgess on behalf of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee to kick off questions. Ariane.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, First Minister. The Local Government Housing and Planning Committee is holding a series of sessions on the Scottish Government's Housing to 2040 strategy. The expressed ambition of Housing to 2040 is for everyone to have a safe, good quality and affordable home that meets their needs in the place they want to be. In the sessions we've held today, significant concerns have been expressed to us about the deliverability of Housing to 2040's ambitions, and in particular in the context of the cuts to the affordable housing supply budget. Are the ambitions of Housing to 2040 still realistic? And if so, how does the Scottish Government intend to deliver on them?
They are realistic, and they are still very much our aims. I don't doubt for a minute the significant concern that's been raised in relation to 24-25 budget in regards to housing. I understand it. We've been upfront about the reasons for that. We have had a over 60% cut to our financial transactions. We know how important financial transactions are in relation to this particular matter, and of course, as has already been referenced, a £1.3 billion cut to our capital budget over the next 5 years. I cannot say, and I cannot look people in the eye and say that a £1.3 billion cut is not going to have an impact. It's going to have an impact. We're going to have to find ways of making savings, and that's why one of the streams of work streams that Paul McLennan, Housing Minister, is engaged in is in a housing investment group or task force that is looking to seek to try to leverage in again some private investment through that housing investment task force. So we don't doubt the challenges that absolutely exist. That is, of course, for Budget 24-25. If I was to look over the longer term, and of course I think that is important in any issue, but particularly in relation to house building, we have a strong track record of building affordable homes. We have a good track record in comparison, not just to previous administrations, but actually to current administrations across the UK in terms of the houses that we are building. So I'm not taking away from the challenges that exist in 24-25, not taking away from the concerns that have been raised by NGOs, third sector and others. But we are absolutely committed to those aims in Housing 2040.
Thanks for that response. You'll be aware that the quarterly housing statistics were published this week, and that the number of new home completions fell by 11% and starts fell by 24% in 2023 compared to 22. So I recognise that that's a quarterly snapshot, but it does help us kind of keep track of where we're going. And I'd be interested to understand how the Scottish Government intends to reverse the decline.
Yeah, again, I think through any objective measure, people would recognise that there has been over the last year some pretty significant challenges, inflationary pressures in particular. And again, without straying too much into the politics of that, we know that there's a number of reasons for those inflationary pressures, but one of them, that disastrous mini budget and the impact of that from the UK government. So we're continuing to face those inflationary pressures. We were facing those inflationary pressures. Inflation now beginning to come down, which of course is welcome. We have the wider impacts of Brexit and wider market conditions as well. But I fully accept the concern that has been raised by third sector partners in relation to housing about the challenge of the cut to the affordable housing supply programme. And that's why the Deputy First Minister made it abundantly clear that if there is an increase in capital, then the priority will undoubtedly be the affordable housing supply programme. We didn't see through the spring statement additional capital, and we asked the UK Government to reconsider that point. But I go back to the point I've made in the longer term on housing. We have a good and a strong track record. I don't want us to lose that or fall behind. And that's why we'll always seek to see how we can leverage in, for example, private investment as well into housing and house building.
That's good to hear about the you know, working out that investment piece. One of the key concerns that have been highlighted to the committee in the Housing to 2040 sessions was the ever-growing pressure on the homelessness services and temporary accommodation. And I would be interested to understand how the housing bill introduced yesterday could potentially assist in responding to these pressures.
There's a lot in the housing bill which I'm very, very proud of, and that will help in specifically to addressing the issues around homelessness, and certainly making sure that that problem that challenge we face in Scotland is in no way exacerbated. So rent controls and having a more a stable and permanent rent control scheme available to apply, I think will assist. I do think it's important that we recognise a number of countries across Europe have some form of rent control in one way or another, and it doesn't necessarily lead to a lack of investment in the private rented sector. There's countries and examples that we can point to where there have been rent controls in place and there's been a continual flow of investment into the private rented sector. So we are leaning on some of the expertise of those who are in the financial services in Scotland to make sure that we're explaining some of the policies that are within the housing bill in order to ensure that we continue that flow of investment, which is going to be required for our private rental sector. I should say also, in terms of homelessness, there is nobody within the Scottish Government, of course myself included, as the First Minister, that doesn't acknowledge and understand the severity of the challenge around homelessness, and that's why, in the face of that really difficult budget settlement, you know, I've talked about capital, but we're also looking at a £500 million real terms cut over 2 years of our budget, that actually what we've done is protect the homelessness budget for the next financial year, despite what I think is the most challenging budget since devolution.
Broaden it out to the economy more generally, I'm going to call Claire Baker on behalf of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Claire.
Thank you. Part of the Economy and Fair Work Economy's responsibilities is tourism, and this morning Visit Scotland have announced that they're going to close the remaining 25 eye centres. That was after 39 closed back in 2017-2019. So I'd be interested to know, did the government know this announcement was coming this morning? What discussions they've had with Visit Scotland about the closures? And if there's any evaluation being taken of the impact, looking at where the centres are, five of them are in the islands, and the majority of them are still in rural locations, and I think there will be some concerns about the impact on the rural economy. So, yeah, did the government have this discussion prior to the announcement, and you know, what do you evaluate the impact to be?
Look, we have obviously regular discussions with Visit Scotland. I fully accept that there will be some level of concern around the announcement. I think there's also, though, a recognition that the way in which we seek information when we travel to tourist destinations has changed. Most of us here will use an app, or we will go online. That is not to say that visitor centres, information centres, don't have a place among some people, and they will find a use and interest of them, but the way in which people seek information, find information on tourist destinations has rapidly and vastly changed. So my expectation of Visit Scotland, and they know this, of course, would be to engage with the communities based in these tourist destinations to ensure that they fully reassure them about what is in place in order for people to seek information about those destinations, even when information centres are closed.
And Visit Scotland, you're correct in their analysis of why they're looking to close and to put more investment into online services. Are they sufficiently funded to provide, to improve the online offer that they have at the moment, which, if they're closing the centres and they're talking, you know, I think could do with a bit of improvement and a bit of investment going in there. Are you confident that will that the resources that were released from this would deliver that?
Yes, I'm confident that Visit Scotland have what is required in terms of the appropriate levels of funding to enhance the digital offer. I would say their digital offer is very good at the moment. I think that probably most of us have used, around this table, have used Visit Scotland's website at some point or another. I think it's a very good digital offering indeed, but I think it can be enhanced. And of course, there could be savings that would be made undoubtedly through the closure of the centres, as has been announced. But I go back to Claire Baker's initial point, and I think it's the absolute right one, that any decision of this nature, there should be appropriate levels of engagement and consultation with the local communities, because there will be a number in remote and rural and island communities that may well be concerned about the announcement that's been made. But I completely understand the rationale and reasons for it. And I do think Visit Scotland are appropriately funded to improve and enhance on the digital offer, which I think is already quite a good one.
Could I ask about the Fair Work Convention? So they've published their first Fair Work in Scotland report that says that faster progress on fair work is urgently needed if Scotland is to become a fair work nation by 2025. And while the report recognises areas where Scotland is doing well, there are areas where we need to see improvements, including disabled workers. You may be aware that the committee did a bit of work on the disability employment gap, and we're going to return to it before summer. So I suppose I'd be interested in what the First Minister's engagement has been with the Fair Work Convention's report, and in particular, what efforts been made to recognise how we need to make progress on closing the disability employment gap. We have made some progress, but the concern is unless we fully understand how we've made progress and what else needs to be done, we'll reach a plateau and we'll not be able to reach the target.
Yeah, we're still fully committed to that in terms of fair work nation. I should say I've met with the chairs of the Fair Work Convention. I met with one of the chairs. I think one of the chairs was unavailable due to a family engagement. But I'll continue myself to engage as First Minister with the Fair Work Convention, as well as, of course, expecting the Cabinet Secretary to do so as well. The concerns around the disability employment gap are one that I recognise, and Claire Baker and the committee have raised on a number of occasions. I recently, last week, met with disabled people's organisations in a round table that was hosted, and I'm grateful to Glasgow Disability Alliance for hosting. And access into employment came up as a topic of conversation, as Claire Baker would expect. So we'll continue to invest in that. As Claire Baker recognises herself, there have been improvements. It goes back to the question that was asked, I think, previously by both Sue Webber and touched upon by Richard Leonard around the skills opportunities. And we've got to ensure that everything we are doing within the skills landscape, within the education, training and employment landscape, is absolutely understanding accessibility issues. And although Claire Baker has very understandably asked me around the disability employment gap, there are others that are who are still struggling to get into the workforce through no fault of their own, but because of the institutional barriers that exist. And therefore, as well as disability employment gap, we're looking to seek to ensure that there is full access into the employment market for anybody that faces institutional barriers.
Claire, I know you've got further questions. I'm going to go on to bring in other members, and I'll come back to you at the end if I can, if that's okay. I'm going to ask Colette Stevenson on the issue of child poverty on behalf of the Social Justice and Social Security to question next.
Okay, thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, First Minister. The Scottish Child Payment has been the flagship policy for tackling child poverty. And going forward, do you expect that this will be the central policy for meeting the 2030 targets? And can you talk about other actions the Scottish Government will take to reduce child poverty as well?
It will always be certainly a central policy. The Scottish Child Payment is rightly lauded and praised as a game-changing intervention by stakeholders, and obviously is increasing next year. And there'll be organisations, charities, NGOs that will want us to go even further in relation to Scottish Child Payment. I suppose from a Scottish Government perspective, we just have to get the balance absolutely right between a level of intervention that absolutely will help us to reduce child poverty and making sure that we're creating the appropriate incentives in relation to work. And we think we've got that balance right, but let's keep that always under review where we can. The Scottish Child Payment alone is modelled to lift 60,000 children out of relative poverty in 24-25. And the other interventions taken as a total will seek, estimates suggest, will lift 100,000 children out of relative poverty, which is really significant, again, given the headwinds that we're facing in terms of a cost of living crisis and so on and so forth. I mean, the last point I would make on this is that there are, of course, interventions that we can and should continue to make, and a lot of those within the social security space that Colette Stevenson and her committee looks at with regularity. But there are also some levers that are not within our hands. For example, just lifting the two-child limit alone, that we know experts have suggested would lift 250,000 children out of poverty across the UK. And of course, introducing an essentials guarantee and changes to universal credit could make a significant difference. So we'll do what we can within our powers, within our budget, but also I'd seek I would urge the UK government to make the appropriate changes that could actually, literally, quite literally overnight, help us to reduce poverty in Scotland and across the UK.
Okay, thank you. That's really helpful. The next area I was going to ask you about was the minimum income guarantee. Now, whilst I understand that the final report isn't due out until the end of this year, would you be able to comment on the progress thus far and any interim findings on that?
Colette Stevenson is right. The expert group are due to publish their recommendations this calendar year. We know, first of all, that support for minimum income guarantee is building. That was shown by the recent Poverty Alliance annual conference. Delegates discussed the need for transformational change and priorities towards a minimum income guarantee. So the expert group are considering the potential impacts, the delivery for both households and also the wider economy and indeed society. And the recommendations will consider costs, they'll consider legislative powers, delivery mechanisms, because ultimately we want to ensure that when we take forward a policy such as this, then that it's deliverable. And that's why the work of the expert group for me is so important, that independent group of stakeholders to consider feasible steps towards delivering a minimum income guarantee. So there's probably a little more I can say than that ahead of the publication of the recommendations later this year.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. And we now move on to Constitution and Culture. And I call Claire Adamson on behalf of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee. Claire.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good afternoon, First Minister. Following the publication of the committee report on how devolution is changing post-EU, the committee held an event with Strathclyde University Law School to consider the report findings and recommendations. Participants were drawn from a wide range of professional backgrounds, including politicians, Scottish Government, Scottish Parliament officials, public, private sector lawyers and academic public lawyers, political scientists, and in addition, PhD students from across the United Kingdom. The note that was prepared by one of our committee advisers talks of the chilling effect of UKIMA on devolved policy making, the shadow of parliamentary sovereignty that gives the UK government an upper hand in any dispute with devolved governments. And in a general level within the room, there was a broad agreement that the pre-EU withdrawal conditions of consensus and cooperation have broken down. And I'm much interested in the room about whether and how this can be restored. So, First Minister, can consensus and cooperation post-EU be restored?
I'm mindful that the convener will tell me to be brief, so I'll do my best in this question. I know in response to the committee report, Ms Robertson, Angus Robertson, indicated the Scottish Government's view that there is a need, I think the committee's overall recommendation and conclusion, the need for new intergovernmental relation agreements to reflect the complex and evolving post-Brexit landscape, I think it would be fair to say. My concern really is that the approach of the current administration in the UK is one that seeks to undermine devolution. The Internal Market Act, for me, is an absolute example of that. That's just not my view. Of course, it's a view that's shared by the Welsh government, although I've engaged only briefly with the Northern Irish government. I'd be keen to hear their views around devolution and the current structures in place. And ultimately, it's a far cry from when how previous prime ministers have approached this issue. If I take, for example, David Cameron's government, of course, Lord Cameron now There was fundamental disagreements, of course, on a whole range of policy issues, constitution, of course, included. Yet we had two governments that were able to get to a position where the democratic will of the people of Scotland and the devolution settlement of this parliament was respected, sitting around the table, let's take the most contentious issue of the constitution, and there was an agreement there. The Edinburgh Agreement, which allowed, of course, a referendum to then take place, even though we had diametrically opposing views of that issue. We are a far, far cry away from that, where devolution, in my mind, in the mind of many experts, seems to be undermined, not just with the Internal Market Act, but the uses of, for example, Section 35 powers. So there is a significant concern around overreach. And that's why I agree with the committee's overall conclusion that new intergovernmental relation agreements are needed to reflect that very complex and evolving post-Brexit landscape.
Thank you for that answer, First Minister. There has been concern raised, as you say rightly, and I'm involved in a couple of inter-parliamentary forums. We now have Stormont back up and running. These concerns have also been raised by House of Lords committees as well. And one of the suggestions is that some, and there's a paper by Gordon Brown recently as well, that some of the conventions be put into statute, like the Seoul Convention. Do you think post the UK election there might be an opportunity to examine how we might move forward with a review of how we operate post-EU?
Because it's certainly my hope that there's an improved relationship if there is an incoming UK Labour government. If there was, unlikely as it may seem, if there was even a continuation of the current UK government post general election, I would hope that it wouldn't take a general election for there to be a change in approach. I hope that the current UK government could, the current party within government at UK level could look at the damage that's being done to devolution more broadly and the undermining of our institutions more broadly by their actions and just take a different approach now would be far better than having to wait for an election and then a potential incoming new government. For me, the Seoul Convention is just the absolute example, as well as the Internal Market Act, the Seoul Convention, a real example of the fundamental undermining of our devolution structures. And it's not just myself, previous Welsh First Minister Mark Drakeford regularly raised concern of the fact that the Seoul Convention was breached time and time and time again, not just issues related to Brexit, but often when it came to Brexit-related legislation. I will look at good ideas wherever they come from. It's in Gordon Brown's piece of work, which I think has some merit. I don't think it goes nearly far as it probably should. I have a great deal of respect for Gordon Brown and the work that he has done, but I don't think it goes far enough. And we've already seen some examples of where the UK Labour Party are already rolling back on some of those recommendations from the Brown report. But look, whichever party is in power, be it in the UK government or indeed in the Scottish government, it's really important that there's the appropriate mechanisms in place for good intergovernmental relations.
Thank you, First Minister. I'm looking to convene. Can I ask briefly, Nick, on another subject? First Minister, you committed to increase the Scottish Government's investment in arts and culture by £100 million by 2028-29. The culture sector has experienced what has been termed the perfect storm with COVID and Brexit, and also with the cost of living crisis. Are you able to give any detail or what your priorities will be for that spend going forward for our culture sector?
So there has been an increase, obviously, in next year's budget in terms of the culture sector. It's the first down payment, if you'd like, on that £100 million that we have promised by financial year 28-29. And in 2025-26, we'll aim to provide an additional £25 million to the culture sector. So we're trying to give some forward look in terms of additionality coming forward. So it allows the culture sector to plan and to thrive going forward. I don't need to tell Claire Adamson at all about the value of the culture sector, not just here at home, but abroad as well. And that increase is coming despite a very challenging budget situation, as I've already referenced as well. So through this increased investment, we want to drive up participation in particular, in creative pursuits. We want to support the production of new works as well. And crucially, as I've already referenced, we want to ensure that Scotland's cultural output has not just platforms at home, but also crucially abroad as well.
Thanks, Claire. I've got a couple of brief supplementaries at the end. I'm going to come first to Kenny Gibson, then to Claire Baker.
Thanks very much, Convener. The Scottish... Scottish Parliament Corporate Body and the Finance Committee have both expressed concerns about the growth in the cost and number of public office holders. So these commissioners, in the financial year that's about to begin, have had significant increases higher than, for example, any portfolio across the Scottish budget. One of the concerns that we have in terms of these commissioners is not only the cost, but also the inability for them to be actively scrutinised. So I'm just wondering what the Scottish Government's view is in terms of these commissioners. So, for example, do you feel that there should be more? There should be fewer. They should just let Parliament decide and let it grow organically. Should there be sunset clauses, for example, so that once the initial mission is accomplished, they could be abolished? We're about to undertake an inquiry on commissioners. It would be quite interesting to hear what the Scottish Government's view of this is at an early stage, because there's a kind of philosophy for organisations who... Do not
First Minister, you get the drift. First Minister.
I do. We should have a commissioner that looks into these issues. No, I don't think that's the case. I think in all seriousness, the point Kenny Gibson makes is absolutely right. I probably broaden it out to the points that the Deputy First Minister has made to the Parliament around public sector reform. I think there's an understanding around the complexity of the landscape, the size of the landscape, and having to perhaps simplify it, and where necessary, make further efficiencies within the public sector landscape. And of course, doing that with our trade union colleagues, doing that with the workforce. I would say, look, it's not for me as the First Minister to necessarily dictate to Parliament in terms of members' bills that come forward and other bills that create commissioners. There's a number of bills that are in the ether or that have been suggested for introduction, and some of those bills have a commissioner attached to them. And of course, we would then debate the merits on a case-by-case basis. I think some of the proposals that Kenneth Gibson has mentioned around potential sunset clauses are well worthy of consideration and merit. But if I can give a reassurance to Kenneth Gibson that this is all part of the work that the Deputy First Minister is looking at in relation to public sector reform.
OK, thanks. And given that she raised the issue of closure of eye centres in islands, I'm going to reward Claire Baker with the final question and demonstrate to Kenny Gibson how you do it briefly.
Okay, thank you. Richard Leonard already raised the Audit Scotland report into the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. And while Audit Scotland did talk about the Economic Leadership Group, they did raise issues around transparency and accountability. We are expecting the refresh in the summer, so will the refresh in the summer address the issues that came from the Audit Scotland report?
Yes, we'll see. Absolutely, to do that. I mean, I will myself personally, on the back of Claire Baker's question, look at the progress that we're making in relation to that update. But my expectation is that we will address that issue, but not only within the update, more generally, if I can give an absolute assurance to not just Richard Leonard and Claire Baker, but all of the committee conveners around this table. I mean, we take Audit Scotland's reports extremely seriously. We seek to respond to them, to implement where we can recommendations. And any recommendations we don't implement, we're really upfront about the reasons why we will not take forward a certain recommendation, but we'll seek to do I will personally look at that update and ensure it addresses the issues around transparency and some of the other issues that were raised by Audit Scotland.
Thanks very much. That concludes the session with the First Minister. I hope we can repeat the exercise in about 6 months' time, but thank you again, First Minister, for your attendance. Thank you, colleagues, for your attendance, and I close this meeting of the committee.